The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country. The Startup Hour is a weekly business program bringing successful Zambian entrepreneurs, policymakers, and subject experts to share their stories, answer your burning business questions, and inform you on best practices. Tune in to the Startup Hour every Tuesday from 9 a.m. Startup Hour, in association with Power FM.
A very good morning indeed. Welcome to another edition of the Startup Hour radio show. I'm your host, Patrick Chifuambua, here as always with my co-host, Mwapich Saka Jr. We're also joined by our guest, Joanna Hickey, Damalis. Today on the Startup Hour show, we discuss creativity as a service with Joanna, who is founder and managing director at AdLab Zambia. Joanna manages Zambia's largest non-affiliated full-service advertising agency, providing through-the-line advertising strategies, services, and other solutions to corporates and private clients. The agency has managed key accounts like Saab Miller, UNICEF, ProFlight Commuter Services, and International Hotel Group. In addition to management studies, she serves as principal account director for select key accounts. She is one of the few women who run an advertising agency in Zambia. She's also the daughter of one of Zambia's most prominent media practitioners. Therefore, it is a natural assumption that she would have ended up in the media industry. As per tradition, I have a quote for our guests and our listeners to kick off the show. It goes as follows. Creative without strategy is called art. Creative with strategy is called advertising. That's from Jeff L. Richards. Joanna, it's a pleasure to have you on the show. We appreciate you taking time to share your journey with us and discuss your entrepreneurial and business journey in Zambia and Africa at large. Very good morning to you.
Thank you so much for having me. Good morning.
Mwapi, as always, pleasure to have you.
Today I'm super excited because this is one of those interviews that has been a long time in the making.
So, well, let's get right into it. Joanna, would you consider Lusaka and Zambia at large a creative city or nation?
First of all, thanks. It's a real opportunity to be here. Thank you so much. Incredibly so. I think Zambia as a whole is an incredibly creative country. I think the myth of creativity being a parallel to logic has been debunked a long time ago. Creativity is actually not just about your ability to hold a paintbrush or write a beautiful piece of music. It's really about the skill and talent to recognize an idea and to use it to solve a problem or create something meaningful. I think that the latest evidence of this has been at the TED Talks held this last weekend. There's so many people with so much insight into Zambia, the people, the places, the stories. I think creativity is often thought to be one of those unattainable traits. You either have it or you don't. But it all boils down to really a form of personal expression. If you love something enough to mold it into something better, you're creative.
Amazing. How did you get to the point where you thought, okay, I must be a creative person?
I don't always see myself as creative. I think what made us what we are today was the ability to recognize that different people have different personalities and different things to contribute in order to make an idea or a campaign bigger and better. My love for advertising came from my father, obviously. Mm-hmm. You have the power to change the way somebody perceives something. You can influence behavior by tapping into human nature. Who else gets to do that on a daily basis except an ad person?
Indeed. Well, looking at ads and the way the entire industry itself is structured, you're sort of the guardians of the Zambian brand. Is that correct?
We'd like to hope so. We really would like to hope so.
And if you could just break it down for us, what is the Zambian brand from your experience?
I think that the Zambian brand has evolved over time. I think that we're seeing so much more creativity and possibility in Zambia. I think that the Zambian brand is a culmination of our traditional values and beliefs, our geographical location being in Africa. You know, we can take advantage of all of these incredible assets because that's exactly what they are. You know, so we've seen a lot of unique work coming out of Zambia in the creative industry. So, you know, it's really promising. It makes us very happy.
I just want to take you back a bit. When you say, how would we define the creative industry? You know, that there's many layers, I would presume, of the creative. So if we went from the artist who's, for instance, a musician, to the painter, the sculptor, in our field, the media field, how would we describe a creative?
I think that everyone has the ability to be a creative. I think, as I said earlier, that creative and logic are not parallel opposites. I think being creative is just the ability to be able to look at something differently. Mm-hmm. It's just the ability to think a little bit outside of the box. So that could be from, I mean, even being an athlete is a creative skill. Mm-hmm. What you do with those natural talents, how you hone them and how you develop them, you know, dictates how your creativity can flow. So whether you've had exposure to other creative individuals, or do you work in an environment that's very, very, if I could say, very strict and very rigid, that's not good fuel for creativity. So I think that to be creative, you need to expose yourself to as much as you can in as many ways as possible, if that makes sense.
Indeed. Do you think that our creatives are getting the right exposure now, you know, from maybe 5-10 years ago?
I think that a lot has changed. We still have a very, very long way to go. I think that we need more formal training in the creative sector, because, for example, our graphic designers, a lot of them are not formally trained. They're all self-taught, which is incredible, because we've seen so much skill and so much aptitude and so much love for design come out of somebody who's self-taught, because there's no way that you're going to spend so much time on it unless you really love it. But I do think that formal training opens up the doors to more technical skill, more technical knowledge. It expands your ideas. So I really do think that we need to invest in the arts more. We need art schools. We need design schools. We need drama schools. You know, that's essential for the creative atmosphere to actually thrive and grow.
Amazing. In your eyes, what does an underdeveloped creative or cultural industry look like?
Trying to imagine society without the influence of arts, you'll have to strip out a lot of what is actually pleasurable in life. I mean, if you think about it, you turn on the radio, you watch television, you read. That's all creative arts. You also would remove what is educationally, in my opinion, critical and socially essential. Art and culture boosts economies, yes. It attracts visitors, it creates jobs, it does all of that, but it's so much more than that. I think attending and participating gives rise to social inclusion. We meet over common interests. We learn, we discuss, we develop opinions, we share ideas. So I believe that the cultural industry is essential to social well-being.
And how can we sell creativity as a service?
It's what we do as an advertising agency every day.
Okay.
You know, I think that creativity is not just a tap that you can turn on and, you know, the ideas come out. I think we have to learn to value our creativity. I think we see so many writers and actors and musicians who sell themselves short because they allow other people to dictate the value of their work to them. So a lot of artists are doing corporate sponsorship and things like that, and suddenly a corporate comes in and says, well, I can pay you X to do a concert. It's not always enough. And I think that it's great that creative people do continue to express themselves through their music, even though they're not being paid the way that they should. But I think that the sooner we start recognizing our skill as creative people, other people will start recognizing our skill, you know, and it will thrive as a sector in an industry.
Joanna, one would say that recognizing skill, recognizing one's skill is a skill on itself. How does one recognize their true skills or one's true skills? And then how does one not sell themselves short? Like you gave an example of maybe an artist, a musician who might sign up with a corporate and then, you know, sell themselves short on a particular campaign or a concert or whatnot. How does one recognize that, hey, this is my actual worth on the market?
I think that you have to be prepared to understand that your creativity is a form of personal expression. So Mwape might write a piece of music that he really loves and he really feels is a true reflection of who he is as a person. You might hate it. So I think that that's the whole thing about creativity, is being open to the fact that you might not be able to speak to everybody, you might not appeal to everybody, but I think that creativity is supposed to be sticking to the truest expression of who you are. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot of people tend to overly commercialize themselves, slot into what they would believe to be on trend, and sometimes that can be extremely harmful. So I would urge people to stick with what they believe is their form of creative expression, and eventually people will get them.
Amazing. Is it possible to nurture creativity and the development of intellectual property, right? Because we see a lot of film, a lot of literature, a lot of artwork out of Zambia, but it seems it's not distributed and produced in what you would consider an international standard. Or maybe I'm...
Well, it's definitely possible to nurture creativity. Not only is it possible, it's essential.
Okay.
We need to tap into our cultural value. Our intellectual property is extremely valuable. I mean, look at Rungana Nyoni's film, I'm Not a Witch, that just made its debut at the Cannes Film Festival. It's an amazing example of African rhetoric literally taking on the world stage.
Mm-hmm.
I think we need to develop intellectual property that's uniquely ours and showcase it to the world. I mean, fortunately for her, she had the help of a UK and French production company who saw the promise and the potential in her story. There's a lot of great filmmakers and writers today who have a great story to tell, but no one to tell it to. So we need to bridge the gap and create platforms to showcase our creative talent and let the world know what we're actually made of.
I would want to ask, how do we go about, you know, finding, how do we go about telling a story that's uniquely ours? You know, there's many writers there that perhaps don't know one that they have the skill, but how do they practically go about telling the story? Who's the right people or the channels in this creative industry that one can approach, you know, whether as a writer or a storyteller of some form?
I think that...
How do we organize ourselves to tell our story in our own eyes?
Well, if you think about where Africa came from, we came from a tradition of oral tradition,
mm-hmm.
where literally you get together a group of five people that you tell your story to, and your story moves, you know, across the land, and suddenly everybody knows it. So I underestimate the power of where our, you know, traditional storytelling comes from.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we don't need a world stage to be able to impart a message or for somebody to realize the value in our work. I just think that a lot of people keep their work very close to their chests because they're very worried that somebody, you know, is going to steal their ideas, or, you know, I think that good ideas always come from somewhere. So Mwepe, you might tell a story and I might have something to add to it to make it bigger and better. So I'm not a writer. I wish I was.
Mm-hmm.
So I would, you know, urge people to look into channels where they can kind of express themselves creatively through writing. There are, the film industry in Zambia has really, really, you know, grown in leaps and bounds. I think that at the moment, with the introduction of channels such as Zambezi Magic and 1Z, mm-hmm. for mm-hmm. example, where they're looking for local content. And I think that that's really wonderful, because not only does that give exposure to local writers, but that also improves the quality of our work, because we now have got to be, you know, on par with the rest of Africa and what's coming out of the rest of Africa. So,
yeah.
Awesome. We'll take a short break, Joanna, and when we come back, I want us to touch on copywriting. I know you mentioned the idea of stealing ideas. So maybe we can talk about how one can go about copywriting their ideas or patterning their ideas from a creative standpoint. We'll take a short break.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
You don't need a memory card to listen to us.
All up in your ear. All up in your ear. Giving you exactly what you want to hear. Power on your phone. Power on your phone. P-O-P.
To listen to Power FM, subscribe to Airtel Music on Demand by dialing 551-2997. Terms and conditions apply.
Broadcasting live from Lusaka to the globe.
Number one youth radio in your ears from anywhere in the globe. Live stream us, powerfmzambia.com.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, a very good morning to you. Today on the Startup Hour, we discuss creativity as a service with Joanna Hickey Damalis, who's founder, managing director of AdLab Zambia. Joanna manages Zambia's largest non-affiliated full-service advertising agency, providing through-the-line advertising strategies, services, and other solutions to corporate and private clients. The agency has managed key accounts like Sab Miller, UNICEF, ProFlight Commuter Services, and Intercontinental Hotel Group. Joanna, before the break, we were talking of how one can go about, you know, telling a story in their own words, and how as a nation we perhaps should be telling our own story. And then there's issues that arise. You know, Mwape might be a writer or a singer, though I doubt that. But if one has the ability to write creatively or to sing in a creative form, or whether it's poetry or through song, how does one go about copywriting their works?
I think that copywriting an idea is very, very difficult. It's not the same as patenting an invention, for example, which you can very clearly see, you know, has been copied, or, you know, the idea has been stolen. I think that when you look at the creative arts and expression, what's to say that, or who's to say that I didn't have the same idea as Mwape, and we live poles apart from each other, and our form of expression is very similar. I think that there's been very famous cases, I mean, even with university, where journals have been written, you know, theses have been done, and people have been accused of plagiarism. I think that, to be honest with you, I suppose that it's the highest form of flattery. So I think, you know, people have to be prepared for a really great idea, you know, somebody to want to share it or to own it. I definitely know that for us in the ad agency business, it is very, very difficult, because, you know, you're putting out an idea into the world, and how do you prove that that idea is solely yours? So what we would tend to do, I can only really speak from our perspective, but when we pitch, we would generally say that, you know, whatever is enclosed in this pitch is AdLab's idea, may not be used by the client until such time as we come to an agreement. I know it's very technical, and I know that it doesn't apply to a lot of people who are writing beautiful things or, you know, creating amazing music, but it happens all the time. It happens all the time. So I think that it's a personal, you know, it's personal how you actually deal with it.
There's a perception in the business industry at large that, you know, we tend as Zambians to steal ideas. You know, I'll open up a shop, and then the next thing, Mwape comes and opens up the similar business or similar concept because he perhaps perceives me to be thriving. How do we go, and maybe from that angle, how do we go about protecting our business ideas or business concepts in the creative industry?
I think there will always be somebody who has a similar idea to you. So you could open up two identical stores, but the difference between the two of you could be that Mwape does his customer service really, really well. So that is what makes you unique. I think that people focus too much on the nuts and bolts of things that make them unique, and I think that we need to go more to qualitative aspects of the business that make you unique. So two people might sell exactly the same Batman t-shirt. You've got a Batman t-shirt on. Two people might sell exactly the same product. It's how they sell it, how they approach the client, how they speak to the client. What is the after sales support on the Batman t-shirt? You know, that makes it different. So sometimes people don't mind paying a premium for the fact that, you know, 2 weeks down the line, Mwap is still there for them and can still communicate with them, you know, as opposed to someone who says that once I've sold you a product or a service, I'm gone, the deal is done, let's move on, you know.
So still on the issue of protecting one's ideas, why is it important to have, and I say this off the cuff, why is it important to have non-disclosure agreements, you know, when you're dealing with creatives?
Because, well, evidently it's because we steal each other's ideas a lot.
Because you mentioned when you're dealing with clients, you know, you would have a technical issue to say, okay, we will not discuss ABCD until such a time that we sign this agreement. Yeah. But why is it important to have non-disclosure agreements?
I think that, you know, the one thing is, again, going back to the value of an idea, the value of the creative, you know, industry. We don't have something tangible that we sell. We sell what comes out of our brains. And I think it's very difficult to, sometimes it's very difficult to attach a value to that other than the amount of time that it takes. But inevitably, our ideas would be what make a client unique, would make a client stand out, would allow a client to get the competitive advantage to sell product and service. So I think that it is very important to be able to protect that through a non-disclosure agreement, because you wouldn't walk into a shop and take something off the shelf. And it's exactly the same principle, you know, taking somebody's idea and using it as your own is exactly that. It's, you know, it's theft. So I really do think that, you know, I was actually coming here, I was listening to the radio and about how they're trying to help to prevent the piracy of music by incorporating the hologram into, you know, and yes, has it been effective or not? But that's just one method of how people are trying to protect themselves to stop pirating music. But what are the punishments? What are the effects if you do? So I think that we've got the control in order, you know, the control is in place, but what are the, you know, what are the repercussions for pirating music in Zambia, you know? So I think it's important that creative people do try to protect themselves as much as possible. They don't have something tangible. It's all in here.
And when you say creative, that's like from the musician to any form of artist, right?
Absolutely. A chef could be a creative. I mean, if they've got a recipe that they use for a dish that has made them famous and someone steals it, you know, it's not theirs anymore. Again, it's theft. You can create something similar, but it might not be exactly the same.
Yeah, that's amazing. It's good that you touched on that point, because there's this issue in Zambia where an artist is a musician. Like, that's it. That's the definition of what an artist is.
Yes.
On before I move on pitching your idea, I know it's something as creatives we do a lot. You go out and you're pitching your idea. What are some pointers you can give? Because it's I think it's where most of us fail. We pitch either the wrong idea or the wrong concept to the wrong person, maybe.
I think when it comes to pitching, you know, the first thing is to really understand your own idea and your own concept. Get your head around it. I've seen a lot of pitches, you know, fall flat because you have a great idea, but you haven't really thought it through and you haven't prepared yourself for the questions that are going to come. So you fall flat there. You have to really believe in what it is that you're pitching. And again, you have to make sure that you're pitching to somebody who understands, you know, what it is that you're trying to say or do. I think that probably I would say that confidence is the number one thing with a pitch. When you walk in jittering and not able to construct a sentence, it immediately sets the scene for how people think that the rest of it is going to play out. So even if you have no idea what you're talking about, it's essential that you act like you do.
All right. Now, moving on. From being an employee to running your own business, this is the Shangri-La of everyone's issue with business. Say, okay, I'm working, my job's good, I have a side hustle, but when is the right time to jump both feet into my business?
The right time is now. Yes, there's probably some things that you need to be wary of. I mean, you've got to be prepared to learn along the way. So no amount of research that you do, you know, is going to prepare you for the practical experience of running a business. You know, that's far much more of a learning curve than any 5-minute MBA book can give you, or, you know, online course. I'm not downplaying the value of educating yourself, but you have to be prepared to climb and fall. I also think that the Zambian landscape is very different in comparison to other places, you know. So I think if you've got a good idea and you've got determination, you have to trust the process. I think also leaning on people who are able to provide you with knowledge and experience is essential. If they can save you the trouble of making a mistake or two, then obviously they're a huge asset.
Did you trust the process?
I was very impatient with the process, but yes, eventually you have to learn to trust.
You say the Zambian business landscape is very different. For the startup entrepreneur out there that's looking to jump into it, how different is it?
Again, I think that in the creative services, as you said, an artist in Zambia is referred to as a musician. Mm-hmm. They're a commercial commodity rather than being respected for their brilliance and ability. So I think that when you look at more sophisticated markets or markets that deal more with the creative arts, I think that their outlook on it is very, very different. So they will recognize someone for their songwriting talent or for their ability to construct a beautiful piece of artwork. And it's very commercially viable in other industries and in other countries. I worry here that, for example, there's lots of musicians who have an 8-to-5 job. Mm-hmm. Because they're not able to make it doing what it is they love. And I think that that's very sad. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to work on that. I think we need to grow that.
Yeah, do you think that maybe it's maybe the musicians or the artists, the creatives in this instance, understand their value, but then on the other end of the table, us Zambians don't understand or don't put a value to what they do? How do we go about changing that?
I think that's exactly it. I think that the change starts with us as creative individuals. Mm. You know, I think that when we value our work, you know, it makes people stop and look and listen and think a little bit more. You know, when you go into explaining that, for example, you know, this entire campaign that we've done for you didn't just materialize out of thin air. I mean, it took 6 people working long hours, drinking copious amounts of coffee, you know, trying to come up with something that is unique and makes you stand out. You know, I think that once we get clients or once we get clients involved in that creative process, I think it gives them a better understanding.
Amazing. Moving on to pop culture, right? We live in a time where someone with a YouTube page all of a sudden comes famous and is on TV. They have a TV show, right? Someone from a Facebook video has amazing views, and then they end up becoming a brand ambassador for X brand, right? So should we be using pop culture to portray our society's culture in our creative works?
I think it's just the way the world works. In order to be relevant and in order to stand out, we need to reach people in a way that's meaningful to them. So the youth right now are agents of change, and what better way to reach out to them and converse with them on levels that are appealing and real? Mm-hmm. Culture evolves and changes with time. Our culture is not just about traditional beliefs, you know, where we come from geographically. Yes, of course, it's rooted there, but we can't progress unless our means of communication evolves.
All right. That's quite interesting. So should we all be making YouTube videos and Facebook Vines?
AdLab learns how to be a better agency by seeing the work that comes out of the rest of the world and learning how to apply those principles on our home soil. We can't reach people to change their thinking unless we engage them through their interests. Global trends are exactly that, global. That's why artistic expression has changed to meet these trends. Facebook has about 2 billion monthly active users. Mm-hmm. So if you have something to say, it's the obvious choice for the furthest reach in the shortest amount of time.
All right.
We'll take a short break, and then when we do come back, maybe we can touch on the correlation between creativity and social development. We'll be right back.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
Get interactive with your favorite youth radio station.
Your favorite youth radio station via social media.
At Power FM Zambia for all of your tweets.
FM Zambia for all those Facebook likes and comments.
And for your dose of local and international news.
Visit our website on powerfmzambia.com.
PowerFMZambia.com.
Hi there. We're glad to know you're tuned into Power FM, Zambia's Youth Radio. Please note that we have switched our domain name for our website and email addresses. So, if you want to stream live
or check out the latest local and international news,
go to www.powerfmzambia.com. www.powerfmzambia.com.
And if you're new to send us press releases, invitations of all sorts, new music, or have any queries, simply email us info@powerfmzambia.com.
At Power FM Zambia. So remember to visit our website, go to www.powerfmzambia.com to email us for any correspondence or queries. It's info@powerfmzambia.com.
For direct queries or information delivery to our news or marketing desks, email news@powerfmzambia.com or marketing@powerfmzambia.com.
Switched up, but we're still the voice of the youth.
The power is in your hands. So don't touch that dial.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
Welcome back. Today on the Startup Hour, we discuss creativity as a service with Joanna Hickey Damalis, who's a founder managing director at AdLab Zambia. She also serves as principal account director for selected key accounts. She's one of the few women who run an advertising agency in Zambia. She's also the daughter of one of Zambia's most prominent media practitioners. Therefore, it is a natural assumption that she would have ended up in the media industry. Now, before the break, Joanna, we were talking about the correlationship between social development and creativity. How important is this?
I think it's definitely important. Study after study has proved that there is a correlation between the creative arts and an improved understanding of our world. It's been proven time and time again that young people who have had some access to some form of creative arts introduced into their lives at an early age show higher cognitive ability. This might not come as a surprise, but in school I participated in drama.
Okay.
Effectively, being someone else involves consideration of a character's motivation and behavior. So it improves your ability to understand other people's perspectives. You know, when you have to act as somebody else, you understand other perspectives. So I think creativity allows us to express and trust ourselves. It builds a spirit of inquiry and exploration. And I think that that's the main thing that develops us socially.
Why do you think that we have kind of like neglected the creative arts in Zambia? Why is that?
I'm not sure that we have. I think that you see more and more the addition of arts into school syllabus.
Okay.
You know, you see a lot of outreach programs. You see Barefoot Theatre coming up. You see Circus Zambia, who did their TED Talk the other day. These are all forms of creative expression. And they were telling us about the positive influence that creativity has on the mindsets of, you know, either previously disadvantaged communities, children with disabilities. You know, it's an outlet, it's a creative outlet of expression. So it's a way to channel that positive energy into something good. You know, so I think that we've come a long way, you know, than where we were a couple of years ago. I think that creativity is becoming more and more important. There's art workshops happening all the time, you know, so I think it's about keeping your ear to the ground, you know, and seeing what's actually out there. I think it would be nice to have more, obviously, but we've got to start somewhere.
You mentioned that countless studies have shown that the correlationship is very important between social development. Do you think that the powers that be ought to pay more attention to the creatives in terms of, like, you know, wealth and job creation?
I think absolutely. You know, I mean, we were having a discussion the other day in the office about how when you went to your parents and said that you wanted to be a graphic designer, it was like, I think people didn't understand the creative industry then. It was more lucrative to be in, you know, to do finance or, you know, do something with your life, they would say. You know, carry on and do your little creative thing on the side, but have a backup plan. Now we're seeing educational institutions opening up purely for the sake of creative arts, performance schools. We've got advertising colleges, you know. So I think that more and more the importance of, you know, and the benefits of the creative arts are slowly, slowly showing themselves, mm-hmm. you know, and they're proving themselves also to be quite lucrative, you know, from an economical perspective. You know, in the same way that, you know, we have commodities that we export, we could also be exporting talent. So people need to look very closely at that.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've had guests in the recent past that will talk of, for instance, the fashion industry in other countries on the Northern Hemisphere being a multi-billion pound industry, the music industry, needless to say, being a multi-dollar, multi-billion dollar industry. Do you think that we are on course to harness some of this, these monies if we plow into our creative minds?
I definitely think that we are. You know, I think that we need to look at seriously consider diversifying, you know, the way we're doing business. Mm-hmm. So creative services have got a lot to contribute to an economy. You know, so I really think that we are on course to it. I think that it does need more help and a lot more assistance, but I think that it's definitely a good possibility.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick one, as a writer today, as someone who kind of plays the middleman, if you will, you know, in terms of linking the client, the business to the ultimate consumer, do you have any practical advice on how maybe the powers that be can go about, you know, tapping into the creative industry a bit more, maybe a bit more quickly?
I think that it all starts, you know, it needs to start at a developmental kind of level.
Okay.
So we need to look more into the future than for today. So I think that the colleges of applied arts, you know, graphic design colleges, that kind of thing is something that needs to be started now, so that young people are able to, you know, find channels and good opportunities for their creative outlets. So that hopefully in 20 years' time, you know, these people have gone through their formal education system, you know, they're linked up with opportunities possibly outside of Zambia. So I think all of these things take time, and we can't always be looking at the now. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to be looking to the future.
Amazing. Looking at global trends, right? The global trend now is digital signage. You have everything up on digital billboards. You go into restaurants, there's digital menus. But, you know, certain people still think print still has value. Like in Zambia, we value the brick and mortar so much. So what are your thoughts? Should we embrace the global trend?
I think that contrary to actually what you say, those digital billboards still form part of traditional media. I think that the true digital that I would say that the world is kind of moving towards is very kind of web-based communication. Mm-hmm. You know, we ourselves at AdLab, we experiment with a programmatic kind of buying system that actually it's a little bit creepy, because what it actually does is if you enter something, you know, into a Google search, you know, a product that you're interested in, what it does is it actually tracks your movements through your sites and it tracks your web activity. So when you go on Facebook, you're actually served an ad for what you searched. So I don't know if you've noticed that before, where you kind of go, yeah, but I just entered that into Google and it's presenting
and
me a page.
It's asking
on
me to like.
Yeah. So programmatic buying, I mean, that's true digital. What we're seeing in the rest of the world is, you know, the movement of ads off of the traditional space and into the true digital space, which I would say is online. You know, a lot of companies are moving, you know, large portions of their budget because that's so targeted. Mm-hmm. I think that, to be fair, even though we do utilize traditional forms of media, I think that there's a lot of clutter at the moment. So when you drive down the street, the number of billboards that are there makes it actually very difficult to see anything. And it makes it difficult to actually impart your client's message. And you have wasted exposure. Whereas if I'm able to target you who falls into a bracket of ages 20 to 30, who lives in a specific area of Lusaka, who has specific interests such as tech and music, if I'm able to target you specifically, why wouldn't I do that? So I really think that clients need to focus more on the digital side of things, especially considering now that the technology is available to us at a lower price. You can buy an Android phone, you can buy a smartphone for next to nothing. It used to be extremely unattainable, but now pretty much everybody's got a phone. We have a mobile penetration of, you know, close to 100%, which means everyone, you know, is linked, you know, mobile. So I think that that's definitely the way to go.
Does this then provide the opportunity for us to commercialize African culture?
Definitely. I think from a creative angle, we've seen African culture influencing fashion design, film, you know, over the years. I think it's a great opportunity to put Africa, its culture and traditions in the spotlight. But the one negative aspect is a lazy cliche of painting Africa with one brush, describing it as ethnic and exotic. I mean, those are my least favorite things. It doesn't do much for us, you know, as Africans at all. You know, you see on the runway, a famous designer throws a little bit of zebra print in there and it's described as African. I think, firstly, Africa is a continent and not a country. And we as Africans need to be wary of the generalization because I think sometimes we get sucked into it as well. I think it's critical that the rest of the world learns to appreciate that each country has its own culture, its own style, its own heritage, its own voice. You know, so we need to focus on what is, you know, what is Zambian. We need to put out the best of ourselves, you know, into the world. So I think commercialization of African culture can be a good thing because it puts us on the map globally, but it needs to be done tactfully and with our cultural respect in mind, and not to sell ourselves short because we've got a lot to give.
Okay. Joanna, I want to take you back to what you alluded to when we're talking of traditional media. You mentioned interesting words that I kept here. The clutter. There's too much clutter and there's wasted exposure. Do you think that from the creative side of things, do you think that it's good that we're using traditional medias, as in we're not going online, web-based, we're not using web-based solutions, that we're still on the print, we're still using radio and TV in its most natural form?
I think that traditional media can never really be done away with completely. I think that it now swaps, whereas before something like digital would be used to support traditional media. I think it's the other way around now. The fact of the matter is that, you know, say for example, I walk through your offices here, 7-8 people will read one paper. So you're actually managing to reach a good amount of people still using traditional media. I mean, radio itself is the most powerful form of advertising specific to Zambia at the moment because, you know, it's the lowest cost and the furthest reach. So if you reach a million people and out of that million, 200, you know, get your message, it's worth it. You know, but I do think that things are changing, and I think that we need to kind of get with the times so that we don't get left behind.
Okay, how do we go about getting over the clutter? You know, the wasted exposure. You made allusion to the billboards.
Don't get me started.
No, please do. How do we go about, you know, getting over the clutter?
I think for the moment, the commercial viability of having so many sites up is obviously a big revenue stream for the cities. You know, it's a big revenue stream for obviously the companies. There's outdoor agencies, you know, popping up all the time. I do think that eventually it will balance itself out because a lot of cities have gone through this. Johannesburg, for example, you know, 5-6 years ago, Johannesburg just was a billboard. You know, and I think that over time people have gotten to understand what is effective and what is not. Councils have clamped down on the regulations of where things can be put up, how they can be put up, you know, so that they're not a menace or a danger to road users, you know. And, you know, we're seeing a lot of that at the moment here. I mean, there's sites springing up everywhere. So I think it's all about, you know, being compliant as well, you know, making sure that these guys are, you know, abiding by the laws, you know, and the manner in which they've been told how to do things. The clutter is not something I don't think we'll be able to do anything about soon, but I think it will balance itself out eventually.
Okay. In terms of the billboard, so we just have to wait for the natural cycle of things rather than trying to regulate?
I think so, and I think that digital will do a lot for that, you know, because if you look at the technicality of digital, you have one space that is shared by, let's say, 10 clients. So it means also that the cost is less, there are fewer structures. So I think that because digital, it's more expensive actually to run, there are fewer of the structures around. So I think that when we see the outdoor companies moving more to digital, you know, you may see some structures taken down, etc.
Let's talk about your creative work. I know it's a struggle just writing scripts, coming up with voiceover ideas. That's a hustle. How do you ever experience obstacles in your ideation phase?
We face obstacles all the time. Complete mental block, frustration, the idea just not presenting itself. I think, you know, sometimes it comes to you 5 minutes into a brainstorm session, and sometimes you're days in and you still don't have the right idea. How do we get past them? It's a number of things. I think sometimes you need 60 terrible ideas to get that one spark of creativity, but without the bad ideas, you might not have found it. Yeah. You know, so I think it's about appreciating the different paths you take before you actually finally find the right road. And for us, in our case, it's also about our relationships that we have with our clients. You know, building a level of trust to be able to say, we think we're onto something, but we'd really like your opinion. You know, so we've got those great relationships. I think sometimes also just a good night's sleep is enough to get the creative juices flowing again.
It's quite interesting because you also involve the client during the creative process, which is something I find most of us don't do. We'll create in our own little corner and then go out, and then the client says no, and then we're like, they don't know what they're talking about.
Mm. But sometimes they don't. But but who better to tell you, you know, who better to give you the brief? Who better to tell you what qualities and what characteristics that you need to focus on in terms of their product than your client themselves? You know, I think sometimes it's arrogance for us to assume that we know everything when you've got a brand manager who's been sitting working for the client for, you know, the last 10 years, who knows that product better than we would ever hope to. So I think it's really important to involve the client in your creative process.
Just a quick one. Do you think that your clients now in general, do you think that they are more targeted in how they try to roll out their campaigns? In other words, do they do a one-size-fits-all kind of campaign or strategy now? No. Now that we have so many things going on in Zambia in terms of, you know, billboard and different media forms and whatnot.
No, it definitely used to be a kind of what we would call a spray and pray.
Okay.
You know, kind
spray
of
and pray.
You know, where you just put it all out there and just hope that somebody picks it up.
Mm-hmm.
I think that also that was the time when there weren't as many radio stations, mm-hmm. there weren't as many TV stations, there weren't as many newspapers. The channels, the mediums to get your message out just wasn't there. So I think that now, over time as well, I mean, look at Power FM being a youth radio station. People have identified, you know, they've come to formulate an identity and a specific targeted demographic of people that they want to talk to. So I think that any product that's targeted at the youth would be very well fitted here, and I wouldn't go and put it on an adult contemporary radio station because I'd just be wasting my time. So I really do think that now, especially as media buyers, I mean, we've seen the diversity of media, and it's really nice now to be able to make a very informed decision and to be able to tell your client, well, I think you should use this channel because these are the people that they're talking to. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of, well, we put it on X, mm-hmm. we hope that it has the right effect. So we're also able to make better decisions when it comes to media buying and procurement now because there's so much more selection.
Creative work is quite draining mentally, I'm sure you're aware. How do you keep yourself motivated and interested in your work?
So at Adlab, we try to look at things a little bit differently. We always start off, you know, when we're brainstorming for a campaign, we always start off with asking, what's the obvious choice here? What would the obvious campaign line be for this product? Mm-hmm. What would the artwork be expected to look like? Then we take all of those ideas and we trash them. Because at the end of the day, we don't get called in to present the obvious. You know, so the work is motivation enough. I think that we have the great privilege of being able to deal with different people and different clients and different products. So no 2 days are the same for us, which definitely keeps us on our toes. Mm-hmm. So that's definitely motivation enough.
Amazing.
Go ahead.
All right. Biggest issue around growing an ad agency in Zambia?
I think... I think it varies from person to person, industry to industry. As I said earlier, I think offering a unique service is key. I really do believe, you know, without doing a shameless punt, I really do believe that we go the extra mile to do more for our client than what we hope other ad agencies would. So, you know, I think it's also about understanding, forming relationships and building relationships with clients. In terms of obstacles, I mean, there's a concern about finance. I just think that the ability to grow your business is very dependent on finance. Sometimes you can't fund your own growth. And I hope that this changes. I really hope that, you know, financial institutions and, you know, they get to understand the value that young people are having. You know, they're coming up with startups, they're coming up with wonderful ideas, and they need somebody to give them a leg up. You know, in other countries, we see special funds developed specifically for this. And yes, I know that it's starting now here in Zambia, but I would just like, you know, to encourage people to see the value in that crazy idea, because I'm pretty sure that no one really imagined that Facebook, which was what started as a campus socializing platform, would end up with, you know, 2 billion users a month.
And people actually waking up to do, that's the first thing they do.
Absolutely.
Okay. I want to rephrase the same question, Mapi, threw at you, which is the biggest issues around, you know, growing your business. But maybe what are some of the biggest issues you see growing a creative business in Zambia? You mentioned one, finance. Maybe we can address some of the other issues that you see in growing a business, a creative business in Zambia. We'll take a short break. We'll be right back.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
The station that brings you fresh, local, and international news. Power FM News Headlines.
In the news this morning, the Zambia Bureau of Standards has advised Zambians to promote local products. A Lusaka-based clergyman has clarified why some men and women of God demand money for providing anointing oil to people. The ruling Patriotic Front has distanced Republican President Edgar Lungu from the treason case of opposition United Party for National Development President Hagainde Hichilema. In international news, rescuers have been using boats and military armored vehicles to reach people affected by flooding and landslides in Sri Lanka. And in sports, Barcelona is expected to name former Athletic Bilbao boss Ernesto Valverde as their new head coach. Those are stories making headlines at 10 hours on Zambia's Youth Radio. For more upfront and reliable news, visit our website at powerfmzambia.com. And for the news in detail, do join us at 12.
Power FM News Headlines. The power, power is in your hands. So don't touch that dial.
The Startup Hour, giving entrepreneurs education, motivation, and inspiration from successful entrepreneurs from all corners of the country.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, a very good morning to you. Today on the Startup Hour, we discuss creativity as a science with Joanna Hickey Damalis, who is a founder, managing director at AdLab Zambia. Now, in the last part of our show, Joanna, we are looking at, my last question was whether if you could address some of the issues that you see or that you face as a creative person in the creative industry. What are some of the issues that you think can be addressed better or need to be done away with?
I'm really not sure.
You mentioned finance before the break. You said, you know, the issue of finance is a bit of a struggle, and I think that's for across the board for most businesses. But what are some of the issues that are more specific to the creative industry?
I think not so much an issue is more, you know, the idea of collaboration. I think that a lot of people set out to start a business on their own, you know, do it all by themselves. But I think that collaboration is key, really, in today's, you know, day and age. Mm-hmm. I think that we need to draw from the strengths of other people. So the one thing, for example, that I wished that I had was somebody with a finance brain. Mm-hmm. I had no idea. I couldn't read a balance sheet. you know, when I started AdLab. So everything has kind of been learned on the job. And I think that if I, you know, if I was able to kind of bounce my ideas off someone who was more financially inclined, I think that a lot of things would be different. So I do think definitely that to be able to collaborate, so if I'm a designer, I need to go and find someone who's going to be really good at selling the product so that together we make a formidable team. Your business has got a better chance of success and survival if you do that. So that's definitely one thing that I think would make a very, very big difference in the way that business is done. Mm-hmm.
As a creative, do you oftentimes not go out to talk to a client, or is it a situation where a client would approach you and ask you to find solutions to their needs or to their targets?
Oh no, absolutely not. I think it's very balanced. So I mean, how do we actually go and find clients is by going to speak to them and to show them that we can do things better or differently, or you know, that we've got very good strategic brains in the agency that are able to, you know, kind of make sure that the brand is built really well and very positively. So yes, we do a lot of courting. You know, and you know, it's not a bad thing. You know, I think that a lot of relationships have been built, you know, by us going to see a client, them going, yeah, but we're happy with our agency, and then, you know, us just saying, look, just give us a brief, throw us a test. You know, I think also because we're such a young agency as well in terms of the people who actually work, you know, together, I think that, you know, it's great because they do see a young team, which sometimes, you know, some people might say, oh, maybe they're a little bit inexperienced, but I do think that we have the freshness of mind, we have that dynamism and flexibility in the way that we think and the way that we do things to be able to provide really good solutions. So we've got a digital side to our agency now as well, which focus, as I said, purely on things like programmatic buying. And I mean, the guy who's running it, Luke, is great. He's young, he's a baby, you know, but that's what's so awesome about it, you know, is that I don't think that you need years of experience. You just need some years of adaptability and learning and love and passion for what you do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you mentioned that you do a lot of quoting to clients. Does that mean that there's a lot of research that goes into studying the you know, the different clients on the market?
Absolutely. I think research is essential. You've got to know who you're talking to, you know, well before you walk into that room. You've got to know what the client is about. I do think, though, that sometimes agencies can go a little bit too far and walk into an office with artwork, for example, to say, well, here's a billboard that we've designed for you. Mm-hmm. We never do that. We absolutely never do that at AdLab, because I think that it's also arrogance for us to assume that we know exactly what a client wants to do and should be doing. So I think everything meaningful and everything positive stems from having a good conversation. So that's what we kind of aim to do, is have a conversation, sit down and say, what are your hopes and what are your wishes for your brand? How do you want to see it develop and grow? And here's how we can help you.
Amazing. What's interesting, though, is when you started out, you couldn't even read the balance sheet.
Mm-mm.
So here's Joanna, can't read the balance sheet and has to pay 22 starving creatives. How do you execute on minimal cash flow?
I think that because we're in the creative industry, we can't think any less because the budget is smaller, you know. Our input is usually greater in these instances, because we really have to employ clever thinking. A lower budget can be the biggest challenge for an agency, but I also think that it can yield the greatest results. We're able to cut through the clutter with a sound argument and great execution, and then it doesn't really matter what the bottom line was to begin with.
That's okay. So I think to sum this all up, is creativity something that can be learned and nurtured, or is it just something that Patrick is born with?
Well, Olympians don't emerge overnight. So that's natural born athletic talent, for example, but that's been, you have to nurture, you have to develop it to, in order to be able to take yourself to the next level. So I think the same with your brain, you know, forcing yourself to explore other routes, to solve a problem differently, brainstorming, strategic thinking, pushing yourself out of your comfort zone. I think all of these build that muscle to promote more creative problem solving. So you can definitely teach yourself to be more creative.
programmatic system, is it?
Programmatic buying.
Is that the next thing in the creative industry, you think?
Well, I think it's definitely the next thing in the advertising
industry. In the advertising industry,
for sure.
Right.
I think that it's cheaper, it's more targeted, it definitely makes more sense. So I think that, you know, I think we should definitely watch out for the way that that's actually being done, because it now puts smaller companies as well. The interesting thing is now you have the same amount of access and reach. Mm-hmm. So a smaller company that might not have the budget for the traditional media, such as the billboards and the TV and the radio, will definitely be able to have some budget, you know, for programmatic buying or for Facebook page boosting, etc. Mm-hmm. So it's leveling the playing field. So it's very interesting now to see, you know, that some brands that you may never have had exposure to before, now basically at your fingertips on your mobile phone or on your computer, there they are punting their brands on Facebook as if they're, you know, multi-million dollar empires, which is really amazing. You know, it means that everybody's got equal opportunity.
Mm-hmm. But I suppose it works in tandem with understanding from the user end that you're creating a digital footprint every time you go online.
Absolutely.
So it's able to track down, see what your interests are, whether it's sports, entertainment and whatnot.
Absolutely. So that's exactly what it is that we're doing. So you might check up on, you know, what was Zambia's under-20s score, you know, and then you would go to a site, for example, like Sportsbet, and you would be fed one of our ads because we're following you. And as I said, it's creepy.
It is.
It's creepy, but it works.
Wow.
Are we safe? Now is the time we shall have our Startup Hour Challenge. Joanna, are you ready for the Startup Hour Challenge?
What is that?
So you're expected to answer with the first thing that comes to your mind.
Okay.
Are you ready, Joanna?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. First one, bungee jumping or white water rafting?
White water rafting.
Oh, nice. What's the best money you ever spent?
I don't know.
Okay.
It must have been something really, really silly. Like something really small and insignificant.
But it was the best.
But one. Yes.
All right. Red or white wine?
White.
The Zambian president asks you to pick the next capital city. Which one would you pick?
I know where this question is coming from. Do I have the option to leave it in Lusaka?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm leaving it here.
All right, okay. What was your best subject in school?
Ironically, math.
What?
And then geography.
Nice. Okay. Spreadsheet or blank page?
Blank page, definitely.
Okay. If you were on death row, what would your final meal be?
I think a pie from Impala.
Okay, cool. So your autobiography is being created. Would you rather have it as a film or a book?
Definitely a film.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Nice. What is the worst advice you ever received?
At the time, the worst advice that I ever received was to basically suck it up and pick myself up and dust myself off when I was really looking for something a little bit more emotional, you know, than that. But inevitably, it ended up being the best advice that I've ever received, you know, to get up and carry on. So
nice, inverted. If you could have dinner with any one person, living or dead, who would they be?
You asked me this question before, and my answer hasn't changed. It's definitely Donald Trump, because I need to know what he's thinking.
All right. What do you want people to say about you once you're gone?
Just that I did something well and I did it passionately and that I cared about it.
Nice. Which of your five senses would you keep if you could only keep one?
The gift of the gab. I need to be able to talk.
Okay. What animal best represents you?
I would want to say a sloth, but I don't think that's very fitting because I'm not lazy. But no, I really can't answer that. That's a weird question.
Okay. What was the last gift you gave someone?
Time to my daughter.
Nice. You also gave me time. Thank you. What advice would you give to your younger self? That Joanna.
That it's okay if you don't know everything. You can't. I mean, I used to beat myself up terribly about the fact that there was so much that I didn't know. But I think that learning comes with experience, and experience comes with time, essentially. So, it's okay to not know something. You know, if you're dedicated, you'll stick in long enough to find out what it is.
Awesome. And what advice would you give our listeners, our audience, the Zambian youth?
Nothing more than for you to have the guts to identify what you're good at and to go for it, essentially. Be open to others. Be open to collaboration. Be open to change. Be open to the evolution of your business. I don't think that I've met one successful person who said that they're happy with where they are. I think that they're always wanting to evolve, change, improve. You know, so just to be open to the fact that nothing ever kind of stops, and you have to aim and strive to be better all the time.
Excellent. Joanna, it's been a pleasure having you on the Startup Hour this morning.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you indeed for tuning into the Startup Hour show. As I say, Joanna, it's been an informative and insightful session all rolled in one. Catch us again next week, same time, same day, as we bring you more influential business and thought leaders. Be inspired. And remember, the only person responsible for Zambia's development is you. So what are you doing about it?
This has been Startup Hour, bringing successful Zambian entrepreneurs, policymakers, and subject experts to share their stories. Startup Hour, in association with Power FM.